हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू अन एकेडमी। मैं सर विजय गुप्ता एंड यस वी आर बी
हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू अन एकेडमी।
यस एंड वी कैन डिस्कस टुडे अबाउट वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक दैट इज सोमेटो सेंसरी कॉर्टेक्स। इन टुडे सेशन विल बी लर्निंग दी सम ऑफ द वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग पॉइंट्स अबाउट सोमेटो सेंसरी कॉर्टेक्स। As you all can see, my chat box is already working, so you can say hi and hello, and please give me feedback about my voice quality. Is it clear? Am I audible to all of you? Yes, dear students, could you just tell me hi or just say me whether am I audible and visible to you properly? You can type the answers in your chat box. In today's session, we'll be discussing the somatosensory cortex. And some of the interesting feature about somatosensory cortex. Yes, thank you Vikas, thank you. Hi Lali, how are you? Great to see you Lali. Today I have taken already two sessions initially at 6:30 and at 8 p.m. Do join me every day at 8 p.m. for free live sessions, which are available all throughout this week and next week also till 31st of March. I am taking complete electrophysiology, like all type of. Yes, thank you, Lali. I am taking all the aspects of electrophysiology, cerebral and basal ganglia in all three sessions which we have decided to cover in this month of March. I would like to bring to your notice that we at An Academy have brought 20,000 free special hours in this month of March for all the students across the globe. Out of which I am taking 10 hours right from tomorrow, like at least from today till 31st of March. So 2 hours are done. I am still left with 8 hours of my free sessions, plus one more session on Thursday, that is at 9:30 p.m. So I request all of you to join me on all the special sessions at 8 p.m. every day and at 9:30 p.m. on Thursday. Let us start with somatosensory cortex. So could you just tell me the Brodmann area number of the somatosensory cortex? Yes. What is the Brodmann area number of the somatosensory cortex? Yes. The area of somatosensory cortex is specifically named as the post-central gyrus. The post-central gyrus is the area of somatosensory cortex, and this post-central gyrus, yes, very right, Lali, it's 3-1 and 2 or 3-2-1-1. The numbers are given on the basis of the overall area occupied, and posterior to this area 3-1 and 2, there is also one more area. What is the number of those areas? What are the Brodmann number of those areas? The areas posterior to area 3, 1, and 2. Yes. What are the Brodmann area numbers which are posterior to area 3, 1, and 2, which helps your somatosensory cortex? Yes. Remember, the area 3, 1, and 2 is primary somatosensory cortex. Whereas the area, can you tell me the which area numbers are this which I am highlighting with blue color here? And you have already answered this area. Yes, the area highlighted in blue color. What is the Brodmann area number for the sensory? Yes, 5 and 7. Very good, Lali. Yes, those are the areas 5 and 7 for sensory association areas. Now remember what I would like to bring to notice to all of you. Please remember that it is not only these are the sensory areas in your cortex. We have sensory area for speech, we have sensory area for vision, we have sensory area for taste, we have sensory area for sound. we have sensory area for touch, which is area 3, 1 and 2. Please do remember that every sensory cortex, every primary sensory cortex always have a sensory association areas. Please remember this rule or this thing in your mind. Every sensory area has a sensory association area. If suppose this becomes your primary visual cortex, which in which all the information is reaching, the area anterior to visual cortex is your sensory visual association areas. If we have a speech area, a sensory speech area, then we have a association areas for this speech. If we have a gustatory area, then we have a association of gustatory areas for the things. So every sensory, yes, very right, Arjun. Sensory area is 17, which is primary visual cortex. In area 19 and 20 is your visual association areas. So the rule here, in the thumb rule, is every sensory area will have a sensory association areas, because receiving the information is not only enough. You need to have understanding of the information. Only receiving the information is not enough. All the information which you receive should be processed, should be understood, and that's the benefit of association areas. There are specific tests for every primary and association areas. There are specific tests for every primary and association areas, and we need to understand those tests. Let us start with the primary somatosensory cortex. Okay, the primary somatosensory cortex is a topographical representation. The area S1 is also called as area S1, and this is called as area S2. Gustatory sensory area is in the parietal cortex or temporal areas. Remember, gustatory area is a very small area, right, in the temporal, in the medial side, not on the lateral side. It's in the medial side, the gustatory areas, not on the temporal side, parietal side. Okay. Somewhere in the area's medial part of the temporal side, the lower part of the parietal lobes. Okay. The S1 area is a topographical representation. The S1 is a topographical representation. Topographical representation. And in today's session, we'll be discussing few interesting things, like which type of test will determine the primary area, and which type of test are specifically for association areas. Okay. So let us just try to understand these things here. Which areas are primaries, and which type of test are checking the association areas. So S1 is a topographical representation of the sensations of the body, and this topographical representation is not on this based on the size of the organ. It's on the basis of the size of the sensitivity of the tissue. Suppose we have big thorax and small thumb. So is it that in the sensory cortex, in our area S1, if I look at a transverse section here, if I take this transverse section right in this manner, okay, and we look from the front, then we'll have an orientation of all the body parts, where legs are at the top and face is at the bottom. So it is inverted. The first point here is the sensory representation is inverted. Second important feature is this representation is not on the basis of the size of the tissues superficially. Yes, very good, Lali. It's homunculus. It is based on sensitivity. So which area from the body will be highly represented in the somatosensory cortex? Can I have answer from the people who are online? Which areas of the body do you think will be very highly represented in the cortex? The legs, the thorax, the thumb, index finger, face. Yes, which area do you think will have a very high representation as compared to the size on the body itself? Face, yes, face is one of the answer. Lali, can you give me some more examples? Face, of course, the ear, tongue, lips, nose, and vision. All these are specifically for sensitivity. Instead of hand, I would go for fingers. Remember, how do you check? How do you check that what is a sensitive for a particular organ? Whenever you buy clothes or whenever you see the texture of your hair, we use only two surfaces in your body, and that is the surface between index finger and thumb and the surface between the lips. Okay, these are the two highly sensitive areas, a surface between the thumb and index finger, because you rub the clothes between two fingers in this manner. You rub the clothes between two fingers and then you check the texture, right? Yes, so 2-point discrimination, that's what I wanted to know. Very good, Arjun. So the 2-point discrimination is specifically for primary somatosensory cortex. 2-point discrimination, you can discriminate between two nearest point possible. In a velvet cloth, you can discriminate between two hair structures between a velvet cloth. So 2-point discrimination is specifically for area S1. Apart from this, location, you ask the subject to locate the area of the touch. So 2-point discrimination, location of the stimulus are very specifically for the primary areas, whereas a test for association area S1 and S2 both. Yes, what is the test which, yes, very good. The 2-point discrimination is very large in the peripheral areas. In fact, for the back of your body, it is almost, for the back it is almost 5 centimeter, whereas for your lips and tip of the tongue or for your thumb and index finger, it is 2 millimeter or less. So lesser the distance between two points, more is the sensitivity, more is the representation. S1 and S2, which is a test which is actually responsible for S1 and S2? Yes, Lali, can you tell me the name of the test which determines the compatibility, or you can say the integrity of area S1 and S2? What is the test, clinical test we do for, which actually help us to understand that both S1 and S2 are working properly? The test is called as stereognosis. Stereognosis is for both S1 as well as S2. Okay, S1 as well as S2. Also, there is a test in which you write something on the skin surface, or you draw some structure and you ask the subject to guess those structure or those numbers or those things which you are drawing on the skin. Can you tell me the name of the test? Yes, a test in which you write certain things on the skin and you ask. There was a movie called as Black. In that movie, Amitabh Bachchan teaches Rani Mukherjee about certain words by writing on his palm. What test is that? And that test is actually for S2. The test is actually for S2. Yes. What is the name of that test? That test is a type of dactylography. Graphia. So loss of this test is called as graphia. Please remember, very true. I think dactylo is a word for this. So agraphia is a discriminating feature which helps you to understand that the lesion is in S2. S1 is intact, S2 is damaged. So agraphia is one of the sensitivity tests for S2. And this condition where S2 is not functioning properly is known as sensory apraxia. The test which helps you to understand that S2 is not working properly is known as sensory apraxia. A sensory apraxia means the person can feel the touch but won't be able to explain the touch. okay, won't be able to explain the touch. He won't be able to explain the pen in the hand, but he will explain that there is something object in the hand. So sensory apraxia is a condition which is due to lesion in the area S2. Let us go to the one more interesting feature, and that is about the visual area, the primary visual cortex, because we have many tests, we have many tests for visual areas, the optic nerve, oculomotor nerve, Snellen's chart, Jigar's chart, Ishihara's chart. So all these charts, all these tests, why there are so many tests? It is because the visual cortex receives huge amount of information, and it's from the visual cortex it determines whether it should go to area 3, 1, 2, area 5 and 7, area of the speech, area of the test, because you determine the test on the basis of the vision, you determine the structure on the basis of the observation, you determine, yes, area 17 and 18. So let me just come to this point, the primary visual cortex and visual association areas. So area 17 and area 18. Let us list a test which is specifically for primary visual cortex. Can you tell me a test in clinical methods or clinical practice which is specifically only for primary visual cortex? Yes. Can I have a thumbs up from all the students also online? I would just like to have your name, because Lali and Arjun being very kind in to answer my all the things. Vikas, yes, very active. So those online, can you just have a Snellen's chart? Yes. Graphasthesia. Yes, very good. Graphasthesia. Thank you for correcting me. It's graphasthesia. It's graphasthesia. The word is graphasthesia. Yes. So thank you, Suchitra. Yes. The light reflex. Remember, the light reflex is the best test only for primary visual cortex. The direct and indirect light reflex is purely for only primary visual cortex. It doesn't require visual association areas. First thing, Snellen's chart requires somewhat information about the visual association area also, but yes, we can take it for primary visual cortex, the Snellen's chart. Then you ask the person to read the numbers in which chart? Yes. Color chart. What is the name of that chart? Yes. Ishihara's chart. Ishihara's chart, I would go for visual association areas. The person can associate his, yes, very good, Suchitra. The Ishihara's chart, it gives the information, it gives the combined information of 17 and 18 both. But it is less of 17 but more of 18. Please remember, less of 17 and more of 18. 17 is required because you want to see the things. 18 primarily because you want to associate the areas. Now there is one more test for visual cortex. We are missing one test here. Yes. What is that test? The light reflex, Snellen's chart, Ishihara's chart and accommodation reflex. Accommodation reflex is again a test for primary visual cortex. Yes, hue test, very good. It's a different hues of colors or grays, hues of gray and hues of different colors are seen. But accommodation test is one of the very typical test which is for primary visual cortex. Now under certain condition, please remember, under certain condition area 18 and area 19 gets affected, which are again visual association areas. So yes, pupillary light reflex, that's what I have just said here. Arjun, very good. Do you know 18 and 19, if they get affected, the lesion in this area is known as what? The person is unable to differentiate. The person will be unable to differentiate between these two types of conditions. Yes, he won't be able to differentiate between these two smileys. What is that condition known as? Cortical blindness, yes, but there is a typical name terminology for this, Lardy. that thing where the person is unable to differentiate these two things, these two facial expressions. No, not color blindness, not color blindness, because it's called as prosopagnosia. The word is prosopagnosia. Prosopagnosia. The person is unable to understand the facial features. See, yes, yes, very good, Arjun. Thank you. We all human beings have two eyes, one nose and one mouth. So the features are same for everybody, but still we are able to differentiate all the individuals in surroundings. Why is it so? Because we have association areas which can associate the distance between two eyes, distance between eyes and nose and mouth, and that gives a memory of that this type of structure is for Vijay, this type of structure is for Arjun, this type of structure is for Lali, and this type of structure is for Suchitra. The person with prosopagnosia will be able to understand that eyes, nose and mouths are there, but won't be able to discriminate the actual reason behind the different faces. So that's called as prosopagnosia. There is one Hollywood movie based on this concept known as Faces. You can watch that movie. It's a very interesting movie. The movie is called as Faces, where the actress is suffering from a condition, prosopagnosia, very beautifully picturized on the condition. Yes. Now, let us go with the olfaction. Even in olfaction, you have a primary olfactory sensation and the association of olfaction. But precisely, there is no different test for that, because for olfaction, you only rely on the person's ability to differentiate the different types of smell or olfactions. You give him clove oil, eucalyptus oil, some type of coffee beans. So the person is asked to smell different type of things and should react those things. So for olfaction, the primary and association areas they are present, but very different, very difficult to differentiate them. Very difficult to differentiate them. But yes, there is one thing. The olfaction association areas is actually more of a memory. It is more of a memory rather than association. Means, if you would remember, if a person, if one of any of your friend is using one type of fragrance continuously, then you associate that person's memory with that type of fragrance. You associate. So if that type of fragrance you have, then you can say, oh, this is the perfume of that person, and yes, he is that guy or girl. So that is the association, but it involves memory. Means it involves the association of visual cortex, or the association of the touch, or the association of your primary motor cortex. So the olfaction association is more of a memory. You ask the person to name the oil or to name the perfume he's been smelling. You ask the person to have, whether it's a clove oil, whether it's a, oh yes, Arjun, I know it's a joke. Girlfriend, bapre, I am getting this response. Yes. Oh, girlfriend perfume. Oh, your girlfriend will get angry. You are smelling perfume. That's true. So, you have association. So, olfaction has a very, very strong memory association, and that's the very benefit of it. In fact, it has a shortest pathway. The things which goes in favor of olfaction is it has got shortest pathway. Second point. Do you know all the sensory information reaching to the cortex has to go through thalamus? It bypasses thalamus. Olfaction bypasses thalamus. It doesn't go through thalamus. It bypasses thalamus. Third point, olfactory nerves. The first order neuron are the receptor itself. So the first order neuron they are receptor itself. They themselves are receptors. Whereas for other body parts, yes, because everything has some evolutionary basis of it. We humans have origin from the animal life, and as an animal they have a very good sense of olfaction, very good sense of hearing, and a very good sense of taste. Remember, taste, animals are prone to particular type of taste. So hearing, smell and taste. Why do you know why? Because when you are sleeping, your eyes are closed, so you are unable to detect your any predator coming near to you, because your eyes are closed, you are sleeping in a cave. So as a alarm, if somebody is approaching to you, a predator approaching to you, the only alarming way is by the sound of the footsteps of the predator. So that's why even while you are in REM or NREM type of sleep, the ear muscles, the inner ear, the middle ear ossicles, their muscles, they never lose their tone. The ear ossicles, they never lose their tone, because those muscles, they are still able to transmit the sound from external ear to internal ear. Very important. Suppose if you are sleeping and somebody calls out your name, hey Arjun, if you are sleeping and somebody calls out your name, then in your dream you will see, oh, somebody is calling me, isn't it, Arjun? Have you experienced this thing? If you are sleeping in morning hours and your mother calls out your name, oh Arjun, 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 and you will feel, oh, why my mother is calling me in dreams? And then you wake up and you realize, oh, she is actually waking me up. That means the auditory impulses are getting mixed with your dream. So it's very important. Your auditory muscles, they don't lose their tone even while you are asleep. Okay. Let us go to gestation. Gestation. Taste sensation. Even for taste sensation, you have primary and association areas. Yes. Oh, you never wake up. That's a good one. But you are wake up right now. You are listening to my lecture. It's like that movie in which the Leonardo never sleeps, and he once he sleeps, he never wake up. I don't remember that movie. That is a very interesting movie about dreams. So primary. The primary and association areas involves again memory and olfaction. Remember, olfaction is one of the important criteria for having a taste association. Okay, olfaction is one of the primary as gustatory area. Primary area is one of the it's in the medial side of the temporal lobe. You people do love only coffee of Starbucks. People do love only coffee of CCD. Why? Because those taste, they are associated with the memory, and those fumes of the coffee on the table, it stimulates those type of olfactory cells, and it gives a very strong remembrance of your old memory. So olfaction and taste, they go hand in hand. Definitely when there is a extreme cold or there is flu, you definitely are unable to have olfaction. If olfaction is gone, even taste sensations are also gone. That's very, very true, Arjun. Very, very good analogy. Definitely, if the olfaction sense is lost, the taste sensations are also lost very predominantly. And yes, that's all for thing. So we have discussed the visual, olfaction, taste, and visual, taste, smell, sound we have not discussed yet. Auditory, we have just taken the part of auditory. Auditory cortex, yes. Sensory speech area, which area? What is the name of the sensory speech area? Sensory speech area is actually your auditory association area. Please remember, sensory speech area is your, which area is that? It's a vernix area. So that is typically your sensory speech area, and vonic area is an association area. Okay, so there is a primary auditory cortex. Yes, very good. It's vonic area and association area. Now the important feature here, please, I would like to mention here one point. When we say it is topographical representation for area 312, right? Topographical representation for area 3, 1, and 2. Do you know what is the word we use for these auditory cortex? What is the representation called as? It is tonotopic representation in your auditory area. Please remember, for auditory area it is tonotopic. Tonotopic means various frequency of the sounds have various areas in your cortex specifically designed for those. Yes, very good, Lali. Tonotopic. Do you know this word tonotopic? Anybody in the group? Yes, temporal, highly in temporal area. And people with a very good tonotopic representation, very good tonotopic representation, has an area called as planum temporale. Planum temporale is an area which is highly developed in musicians. They have very good presentation of tonotopic. Similarly, for your retinal cells, is it that all the retinal cells have equal representation in the visual cortex area 17? I'll go back to visual cortex. Is it that area 17 has an equal representation of the whole retinal cells, or is it different? Okay, different color. Definitely, I'll go for different color. Yes, I just played Holi a long day back. Then I okay. Coming to this point, do you know retinal cells, even they are not represented equally in the visual cortex. In fact, the maximum of the visual cortex, I'm marking green in color, the maximum visual cortex is represented by which area of the retina? Can you tell me which area of the retina represents maximum of the visual cortex? Yes, which part of the retina represents maximum of visual cortex, and which part of retina represents minimum of visual cortex? Yes, very good. Macula is highly represented. Macula is highly represented visual cortex, whereas the other peripheral areas, they are very rarely. This area, the pink area, is only for other visual other retinal areas, whereas green color is specifically for macula. Very good. Yes, I wanted to know this point. So there is a very good analogy behind the sensitivity and the representation. Sensitivity and the representation. Suppose a person is very much frenzy about having cheese and butter. So for that type of taste perception, it will be highly represented in his gustatory cortex. A person is very much interested in listening a particular type of music. So that type of frequency of the sounds will be highly represented in his tonotopic areas. So it depends upon how do you adapt to your daily routine or your usage of those sensory perceptions, and those persons which you enjoy a lot or those in which you are exposed a lot, they are represented in a very highly manner in your visual cortex or your auditory cortex or your gustatory cortex or any other areas. Okay. Eyelid apraxia. Apraxia is something which you are unable to cohere. Cohere means you are unable to cohere the use of it, or you are unable to associate these things. So eyelid apraxia means the person will be unable to have the sensation of closure of eyelid. Closure of eyelid means when we can touch both the eyelids, we can have a sensation that the eyes are closed. A person with eyelid apraxia will not be able to understand that, oh, I should close my eyelid to block the light waves. Suppose if there is a very bright light coming to your eyes directly from the sun, then you have a very good understanding that, oh, I will close my eyes so that I can restrict some amount of light entering my eyes. Okay, this type of understanding is absent in eyelid apraxia. The person is unable to understand the actual use of eyelids voluntary. Okay, person is unable to use actual use of eyelids voluntarily. Means if you ask a person to wink the eyes like this, he may not be able to, he or she may not be able to do that. So that's what eyelid apraxia will be meaning. Okay, the corneal and conjunctival tears may be normal, but with expression of eyelids may be difficult. Okay, so that's what fovea and macula. Yes, very right. I got the answer from all the students here, Lali, and that's all for today's session. I hope I was expressive enough in today's session. And yes, thank you all of you for watching me. Can I have a thumbs up from all the students who are watching me online? Can I just have a last thumbs up from all the students? I would be happy to see a good thumbs up from all of you. And I wish you all a very healthy week ahead, because this is the crucial week for all of us. So all the best for your good health and keep studying. Be at home. We are there for all your studies purpose. Don't worry, I am taking 10 hours of lecture for all of you, 8 PM every day on Unacademy. Do join me, do like me my profile on my Unacademy, so that you will get all the notifications for my lectures. Thank you Yash, thank you Arjun, thank you Prithvi, thank you Suchitra, thank you Lali, thank you very much. Thank you Vikas, bye bye, good night, see you.